Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I am Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and in today's video we will proceed further in the discussion of chapter number 2 from Carl Misch textbook, that is Terminologies and Armamentarium Associated with Dental Implants. But before we proceed, a quick recap of what all we discussed in the previous video. We began with osseointegration, which is also known as secondary stability. After that, we discussed primary stability and stability dip. And we also discussed bone implant contact, BIC. After these terminologies, we discussed Albrechtsen's criteria, 4 criteria to define or determine a successful implant. Then we discussed how to determine primary stability and secondary stability. In short, determination of stability. That is again 2 common methods and 2 outdated methods. Clear? Then we discussed types of implants, under which we have endosteal or endosseous implants, which is the most common one, followed by transosteal and apostial. Okay, we are yet to discuss apostial and transosteal. We will discuss these 2 at the end of today's video. Okay, but until now we have already discussed endosteal implants, under which we have blade shaped and root form shape. Okay, again, root form shape common, under which we have cylinder and screw shape. Out of the 2, screw shape the commonest thing which we use till now. Okay, under screw shape we have various subdivisions based on the one or the other feature, that is 1-piece and 2-piece, small diameter implant and regular diameter implant, and then tissue level and bone level implants. Okay, after that we discussed implant surface, macro surface, okay, macro structure, clear, under which we discussed parallel shaped or tapered, then self tapping or non tapping. Okay, and then we discussed the threads, macro threads and micro threads. Macro threads onto the body, which can be V shaped, square shaped, buttressing and reverse buttressing, and micro threads, the tiny little set of threads at the collar, just at the collar of the implant. Then we discussed the microstructure. Okay, this was macrostructure. Then we are discussed microstructure, that is the surface roughness to promote osseointegration, that can be additive or subtractive. And now in today's video we will proceed further in the discussion by starting with implant connections and platforms. This is a slightly important topic, implant connection and platform, especially platform, because platform switching is a very important concept. It is a most commonly asked short question and viva question during your practicals. Clear? So please note, platform switching, a newer concept, relatively newer concept, not so new. So first we will discuss the connections. Under implant connections, very simple, it can be internal or external. See, earlier the brain mark system had external, that means the implant system began with external connection. Now what is external? See, there are 2 things to be connected. Connections, what are we trying to connect? We are trying to connect implant and the abutment. Okay, so let's say a very rough diagram. This is the implant and let's say this is the abutment thing. Okay, so now we want to connect the abutment and implant. So onto this implant we have a connection chamber. Please excuse my diagrams, they are very rough, just for your understanding. Please refer the textbook illustration simultaneously. I have already told you in the previous video as well. Please refer the textbook illustration simultaneously for better understanding. Okay, so this connection chamber is outside the implant body. This is the implant body and this connection chamber is outside the implant body. And then the implant, for the abutment, the connection is inside the abutment. Okay, so the abutment is somewhat like this. See, this connection chamber is within the abutment body but outside the implant body, external to the implant body. We have to remember, in relation to the implant body, if this connection chamber is external, outside the implant body, its external connection, and if the same thing, the connection chamber is inside the implant body, its internal connection. Simple as that. Just remember the location of this connection chamber, the compartment, in relation to implant body. Outside the implant body, external. Inside the implant body, internal. So we began with external, but this is the common thing nowadays. Okay, so we have emerged. The advancement is that we started with external, but now all the implant system majority have internal connection system. Okay, again, these systems have various shapes, various geometries. Okay, the most common is hexagon. We also have octagon. We also have various other shapes and geometries. Okay, you can refer the textbook figures simultaneously, please. I insist, I request you to refer the textbook illustrations for much better understanding. Clear? So this is all about connections. Under implant connections, external connection and internal connection. We began with external connection, that is Brennemark system, and now we have internal connections. The reason, screw loosening was a major issue with external connections and better prosthetic features with internal connections. Okay. So now we will proceed with platform, that is platform matching and switching. Okay. So we have discussed connections. Now we are discussing platforms. So platform matching and switching. So matching was the common thing earlier, but now we have something called as platform switching. Again, the same question, what are we trying to match? See, there are two main things in the implants, implant and abutment. So if we are trying to connect something, it's implant and the abutment. If we are trying to match something, it's the implant and abutment. What of the implant and abutment? The platforms, the base levels, the diameters of the implant at the collar, this diameter at the collar of the implant, and the diameter of the abutment at their meeting point. So they meet in the butt joint. This joint is a butt joint. The diameter of implant and the abutment are same, matching. That is what is called platform matching. The platform where they meet, the implant and the abutment meet, or rather they connect. The diameter are same, matching. That is why the term platform matching. Now what is platform switching? What we do here is the implant is the same, but for the abutment it's slightly narrower. Okay, this is the rough schematic diagram of platform switching. The diameter of the abutment is narrower than the diameter of the implant, so means we have switched to some other dimension rather than matching with the implant's dimension, the diameter. So the implant diameter is wider and the abutment diameter is narrower compared to implant diameter. So we have switched to a narrower diameter. That is why the term platform switching. Now the greatest advantage with platform switching is the reduction in the bone loss. See, if the bone formation and the, what you call, the biologic width creation has to happen here, it will happen at the cost of bone loss. See, if the implant and abutment meet here in the butt joint, then the biologic width creation will require some amount of bone loss so as to accommodate itself. Whereas here, already the connection is far away from the implant body because of this switching of the diameters, and that is why there will be less bone loss. I'm not saying zero bone loss, absolutely no bone loss. There will be bone loss, but it will be very much lesser compared to the platform matched cases. Okay, so the number one advantage, less bone loss. Second, the soft tissue volume will be much greater. See the dimension difference. This switching adds an extra dimension. It gives more space for the soft tissue volume to grow and develop there. So the second advantage is increased soft tissue volume. Okay, and the third advantage is aesthetics. The emergence profile will be much better in platform switched cases compared to platform matched cases. Okay, so these are the major advantages of platform switching over platform matching. So in this case, we began with platform matching, but nowadays we use or we incorporate platform switching. That is, the dimension, the diameter of abutment is narrower than the diameter of the implant. The diameter of abutment at the meeting point, the connecting point, not the whole diameter. As you can see in the illustration, the figure that I have drawn here, the dimension, the diameter of abutment at the meeting point, the connecting point, is narrower than that of the implant diameter. Okay, so that is platform switching. Now with this we have discussed connections, that is internal connections and external connections. We now use internal connections. Platforms matching and platform switching, we are more into platform switching nowadays. And now we will discuss surgical protocol. See, there are a lot of confusion while using the terminologies surgical protocol and implant loading. See, surgical protocol refers to the surgical part of implant placement, that is insertion of the implant, preparing the implant site, that is the osteotomy, and followed by implant insertion or implant placement. So the implant insertion or placement is called the surgical protocol. Surgical protocol denotes or signifies implant placement, whereas implant loading refers to the prosthetic part. Okay, so don't use these terminologies interchangeably. Okay, they are not meant to be, they are not one and the same, and they are not meant to be used interchangeably. They are totally different concepts. Okay, and they have various subdivisions or subtypes under itself, which are again different from each other. Nothing is same. I really don't understand. I have come across many instances where people use these terms interchangeably. When they are trying to explain implant placement, they often use the word loading. See, loading does not have anything to do with implant placement. Loading refers to the insertion or placement of the prosthetic, because it's the final crown, the prosthetic, the prosthesis which is going to bear the load. At least clinically, we know the forces are going to be transmitted to the implant ultimately, but clinically we see the crown performing the function, that is bearing the load of the occlusion and mastication. Okay, so loading, whenever there is a terminology loading, it refers to the prosthetic part of the treatment. And surgical protocol, the name surgical, that means we have to perform the surgery, the surgical part of the implant placement. Okay, so the implant treatment has two parts, surgical part and prosthetic part. Surgical is denoted by surgical protocol and prosthetic is denoted by implant loading. Now we will discuss the various types of surgical protocol and implant loading. Okay, I hope the content till here is clear to all of you, especially that is connections and platform. See, if you have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comments or my email ID or Facebook Messenger and Instagram. I will answer all your questions. Please do not hesitate. Okay, I am here to reply to all of your queries, and I will discuss all the requested topics. I have already acknowledged all your requested topics, out of which dental implants was the most commonly and frequently requested one. So that's why we began with dental implants, but I will discuss all the topics one by one. Okay, I hope the content, this video, this channel is helping you out, people there, and please stay tuned for further topics discussion. So now we will begin with implant insertion, that is surgical protocol, followed by implant loading. Okay, so under surgical protocol we have various terminologies: one stage, two stage, and immediate restoration. Please listen carefully, this is immediate restoration. And then we have something called as immediate implant placement versus placement in healed site. Okay, so before understanding all these terminologies, let us understand what are the various stages or steps in an implant treatment. So the first step is implant placement, second step is the abutment connection, and the third step is prosthesis. Okay, so 1, 2, and 3, implant placement, abutment connection, and prosthesis. Okay, so these are the various stages or steps. Now, under one stage, what happens or what we do, the implant placement is done plus the abutment connection is also done. Okay, forget about prosthesis right now. Okay, the three steps are in the total implant placement. Right now we are focusing on surgical protocol. See, in implant placement there are two parts, surgical and prosthetic. So under surgical we have implant placement and the abutment connection. Okay, only the abutment connection, nothing else to do in the prosthesis. Okay, so in one stage what we do, we place the implant and we connect the abutment. Okay, so let's say this implant and we connect the abutment. Okay, and then the soft tissue, these are the soft tissue. The flaps are sutured, that means the abutment will be visible clinically and it will look like emerging from the soft tissue. Clear? So this is one stage. In one step we perform both the procedures, implant placement as well as abutment connection. That's it. What happens in two stage? That means we will perform these two steps in two stages. Okay, in two visits, two separate surgical or clinical visits. Okay, so in two stage what we do, we place implant in the one visit, and what we do in that visit, instead of, see, the implant has a connection chamber. Now that cannot be kept vacant or open. We cannot just suture the flaps directly onto it, otherwise what will happen, the soft tissue will grow inside that connection chamber. So that connection chamber has to be covered with something or the other. Okay, I don't mean anything and everything that comes in your sight, okay, or that's within your reach. No, not like that. See, instead of abutment, what we have, you refer to the implant kit figure or illustration in the textbook, that is hands implant kit, surgery kit. Please refer to that illustration and understand what I am trying to tell you. There are even separate photographs, separate illustrations for cover screw. If you scroll down, you just see there is a separate illustration for cover screw. There is an implant holder of various colors. They are color coded. Implant holders, implant, and tiny screw. Just like the screws as we have in the, which we use for our drilling. See, they are just longer. These are very short. Not even 1 centimeter, okay, hardly. So that cover screw is visible. Cover screw is available. It's also called as healing screw. So it's something like that. This is the implant with the connection chamber, and we have a screw. This is the kind of screw to just cover that chamber and the implant, and then we close the flaps. So the flaps are sutured. And that means this cover screw is not visible clinically and it does not look emerging from the soft tissue. It's totally covered. It looks like an edentulous site even after implant and cover screw placement. In the second visit, what we do, we place a slight linear incision or a punch biopsy to expose that area from where we can remove the cover screw and place an actual abutment. Okay, so in the second stage we perform the abutment connection. Clear? So this is the difference between one stage and two stage. In one stage we perform implant placement and abutment connection in the same visit, whereas in two stage we perform implant placement with a cover screw or healing screw, followed by a second visit in which we expose that area of cover screw, remove the cover screw and place the abutment, that is connect the abutment in second visit. That is why two stage. Now what is immediate restoration? Immediate restoration is an extension of one stage, wherein we place implant, we connect the abutment, and we give provisional restoration. Okay, not final, please mind it. We are providing provisional restoration. Now this is not so very recommended. This can also be referred to as immediate loading. Okay, when we will discuss the implant loading protocol, this can also be understood or understood as implant loading, immediate implant loading. Okay, wherein we place the implant, connect the abutment, and we provide provisional restoration. And this provisional restoration is replaced by final one in a couple of weeks or so. Okay, at least within a month. Now, when this is happening, we don't do it regularly. It's highly unrecommended, not recommended at all. It is okay. It is very unlikely. It may lead. It may interfere with the stability because see, we have already understood stability dip. The implant does not have total stability. It is in that stability dip zone. Okay, period. So in that period, loading is not recommended because of the unstability. Okay, there is less stability or inadequate stability. The implant is unstable. Okay, so it's not appropriate to load the implant. But still, we load. Why and when? When the patient demands one. Like let's say it's an aesthetic zone, and let's say maybe the patient has some social gathering to attend or give some public appearances. In that case, we like accept the patient's demand and we do so. But we again counsel the patient, explain the patient with all the pros and cons associated with it. Okay, so this is the third style. Okay, and then we have a very interesting protocol: immediate versus placement in heel side. Immediate placement and placement in the heel side. I hope this terminologies are clear to all of you. One stage, two stage, and immediate restoration. There are three stages: implant placement, abutment connection, and prosthesis in the entire treatment. So if the implant and abutment are inserted in the same visit, one stage, implant inserted covered by a cover screw, and then abutment connected in the second stage, two stage, and if the implant placed, abutment connected, and provisional restoration provided, immediate restoration. Now we will discuss immediate placement versus placement in the heel side. See, this is also a very common thing. Both the things are followed or performed nowadays. I personally feel immediate implant placement is more commonly followed. Okay, because of the patient's demand. Nobody wants to stay edentulous any longer. Okay, that is why there are many patients which demands immediate implant placement. They want everything quick. Okay, so that is why we have this concept of immediate implant placement. Now, in immediate, what we do, we extract the tooth. Okay, now I will explain. Extract the tooth atraumatically. Don't get me wrong, we usually perform atraumatic extractions only. I'm not saying anybody performs traumatic extractions. We do perform atraumatic extractions, but here I am emphasizing on the term atraumatic because we want the maximum bone available. Because imagine, after the tooth extraction, how much bone is available in that socket to engage the implant. Okay, that is my point. To engage the implant, that is why we want maximum available bone in the socket. We cannot afford to lose slightest of the bone while extracting the tooth. No damage to buccal bone or lingual bone or palatal bone, and especially if it's a posterior or multi-rooted tooth, we want interradicular bone intact, because that's where we are going to engage our implant. In the posteriors, the implant, if it is an immediate implant placement, the interradicular bone is the site where we are going to perform all our drills and prepare the osteotomy site for the implant placement. That is why I am emphasizing on the term atraumatic extraction. Usually also it's atraumatic, but here we have to be extra cautious, okay, because our purpose is implant placement. We need the maximum remaining available bone for engaging the implant. Remember, primary stability, it depends on the surgical protocol and the type of implant used. So our surgical protocol begins from here. If it is immediate implant placement, our surgical protocol begins from our methodology of extraction. So what we do in immediate implant placement, we extract the tooth as atraumatically as possible, preserving the maximum available bone. And immediately, the terminology itself tells you, immediately place the implant. Like we extract the tooth, we clear the socket of all the diseased or inflamed components and perform irrigation to cleanse the socket, which is now clean and available for or ready to accept the implant. Okay, so we clear the socket of all the debris and contaminations and we immediately place implant. Clear? This is the concept of immediate implant placement. And what is placement in healed side? Here we extract the tooth. See, in immediate all this is done in one visit, single visit. Okay. Here extraction done, visit number one, and then we preserve the socket because we have priorly planned implants in that site. Let's say if it is some grossly decayed or highly grade 3 mobility tooth. Okay, so obviously the treatment plan is extraction in that case, which is not amenable to any other dental treatments. Okay, it's not possible to save the tooth and it goes for extraction. What we do, we plan extraction, and in the prosthetic treatment plan we plan implants. That means we know that in this edentulous site, which is going to be edentulous after the extraction, we are going to place implants. So what we do, we plan extraction followed by socket preservation, because we know priorly that implants are going to be placed here. So extraction and socket preservation is performed in the one visit. Why socket preservation? So as to maintain the ridge height and width to accept the implant later on. This is the difference. Later on, the implant is going to be inserted later on. And after a period of, let's say, 6 months, 9 months or even 12 months with repeated radiography, when we see the ridge is available or now ready to accept implants, we call the patient for the second visit. So the visit number 2, where we insert implants. Okay, so this is the placement in healed site. That's what it says, healed site. Understood? I repeat once again, immediate implant placement is where we extract the tooth as atraumatically as possible, followed by immediate implant placement. Everything in single visit. And placement in healed site is where we extract the tooth when we have already planned implants for later on. We extract the tooth and we perform socket preservation because we have planned implants priorly. And then once the socket is healed and now ready to undergo implant placement, we perform implant placement. Okay, so these are the various terminologies under surgical protocol. Now tell me, is that these terminologies has anything to do with the prosthetics? No. In these terminologies, did you anywhere come across the term loading? No, not yet. Okay, because loading has refers to prosthetics and this is all surgery. Okay, so please don't get confused while discussing or giving your answers. When it is surgical part, use the terms surgical protocol and or implant insertion, implant placement, osteotomy preparation. Okay, and when it is prosthetics, use the word implant loading, because we are loading the implant with the prosthesis, that is our crown. Okay, so these are the various terminologies under surgical protocol. One stage, two stage, immediate restoration, immediate implant placement versus placement in the healed site. Now we will discuss implant loading, and after implant loading we will discuss the various instruments or armamentarium used in implant surgery. Okay, so we have discussed surgical protocol. Now we will discuss loading. Please refer the textbook simultaneously for the various illustrations and get better understanding of this topic. Now we will discuss implant loading. In the textbook they have discussed armamentarium after surgical protocol, but I am discussing loading back to back with the surgical protocol to get a better contrast of the various terminologies used and the terminologies that we get confused while using them. Okay, so under loading we have various protocol, conventional, which is the most common one, that is 3 to 6 months after implant placement. Clear? After implant placement, a gap of 3 to 6 months in which the implant and soft tissue healing is assumed to have taken place. Then we have immediate, as already discussed, the provisional restoration is provided immediately. Okay, here immediate refers to provisional restoration, and the final restoration is given again as per the conventional protocol, that is after the implant and soft tissue healing has taken place. Then we have early loading, and that is not recommended. Early loading, which is 2 to 3 weeks. Okay, and why this is not recommended? Because it interferes with the stability of the implant. Remember the term stability dip. Immediately after implant placement, the implant is said to be under the stability dip zone or period. Okay, in that period loading is not recommended, and that is why early loading is a contraindicated thing or a less performed thing. It's not recommended to perform because it interferes with the stability. And then we have delayed loading. Delayed loading means after 6 to 12 months. Why? In case if the bone quality is poor or the primary stability was not achieved at the time of surgical insertion, in that case we allow the implants to osseointegrate more or for a longer duration to get better osseointegration, and then once the osseointegration or stability is confirmed, then we load the implant. Otherwise we leave the implant without loading it for a little longer duration, more than the recommended one, that is the conventional thing. Okay, so these are the various protocols under loading, that is implant loading: conventional, immediate, early loading, and delayed loading. As already discussed, even the immediate loading is not recommended, but yes, if the patient or the case demands, then we have to perform it. But here the advantage is the final restoration is provided after the stability is achieved, that is the implant and soft tissue stability is confirmed. Okay, so these are the various terminologies under surgical protocol and loading. So till now we have discussed connections, platforms. Connections, that is internal and external. Platforms, that is matching and switching. Surgical protocol, one stage, two stage, immediate restoration, and immediate placement versus placement in healed site. And then loading, conventional, immediate, early, and delayed. Now we will begin with the armamentarium, that is the surgical armamentarium used for implant insertion. Okay. The main instruments in the armamentarium, actually there are many and it varies from kit to kit. Okay, so as per the kit discussed in the textbook, we will follow the textbook kit and we will discuss the following armamentarium. Okay, so the most important, drills. See, the again, out of all the instruments, drills are the most important things, because with the help of drills we prepare the osteotomy site. Now if you refer to the kit figure, okay, the kit that has been shown in the figure, please see the kit carefully, especially the middle part, the box part in which the drills are arranged, and they are color coded. Please note they are color coded. See, these drills are color coded based on its width. Okay, if you see, if you read that kit thoroughly, it has 3 mm, 3.5, 4.3, and 5 and 7. Okay, so these kits are color coded based on their width. So the the drills are color coded based on their width, and they are arranged in the ascending order of their width as well as ascending order. If you see horizontally, the width, they are arranged in the ascending order of their width, and vertically, ascending order of their length. Length, I think it is 8, 10, 11 and a half, and so on. Okay, so these are the various drills. Now why these various and so many drills? Because it depends from case to case about, like it depends on the available bone, and that's how we decide based on the available bone and the anatomy, the nerve and the foramen and everything. We assess everything and we keep certain distances from all these anatomical landmarks, and based on the available bone we decide which implant has to be inserted. Okay, so that is why we have the drills of various widths and lengths. Okay, because it will vary from case to case. We will perform a proper appropriate preoperative analysis based on clinically and clinical findings and radiographic findings. Okay, so these are the various drills. Now the most important thing to be noted down about drills are these drills have to be used in order. It's not like you can start with 4.3 or you can start with an 11.5 or anyhow. No, they are meant to be used in order. First we have to use in the order of the width. Once the width is finalized, then we have to use in the order of the length. See, they are color coded. So let me start by giving you an illustration. Let's say in a case we want to place an implant of the width 4.3 mm and the length 11.5 mm. okay, so how we will go about it? We will first start with a pilot drill. Okay, we will start with those drills, pilot drills, so as to assess the parallelism. Okay, starting in the beginning only, we will not start with 4.3 mm. Why? Because it will cut a lot of bone and then it will produce heat and hence a damage, that is osteonecrosis. We have come across lots of cases of osteonecrosis or the damage due to heat. That is why if you read the text also thoroughly, it is mentioned, and even while our discussion we have discussed that the primary stability depends on the surgical protocol, that is how we perform the surgery. So in that the factors are our implant shape, implant properties, and the surgical protocol, that is the drilling procedure, how we perform the drilling, the torque, the rotary speed. It's not like you start with the highest speed. You have to accelerate slowly. Okay, in the beginning only we cannot go at the highest speed, or in the beginning only we cannot choose the highest dimension drills. Okay, we have to go slow and steady. As we all know, slow and steady wins the race. It applies in all the cases, even in implants. Okay, so go slow and steady. So when it comes to drills, the primary stability is achieved on the basis of the implant properties, that is macrostructure and microstructure, and the drills, the how we use the drills in the order, in the sequence, the speed of the rotary instrument, the torque used, and the cooling, irrigation. Why we use irrigation? Because heat is produced when the bone is cut. So that is why we have to cut little bone one by one. Okay, slowly little bone, in every cutting little bone is cut. Okay, so in every drill little bone is cut. We cannot cut all of the required bone and prepare osteotomy in just one go. Okay, it's not possible. It will produce a lot of heat and lead to necrosis. Okay, and then again the implant will ultimately become a failure. So no need to go around the case in a hurry. Okay, this hurry is not going to fetch you anything, neither you nor your patient. So it's better to go slow and steady and win the race. Okay, so with the drills we have to go in the sequence. So here, as per our illustration, let's say we have decided to insert an implant of dimensions 4.3 mm width and 11.5 mm length. So how we will begin? See, first we will give the pilot drills, and now you refer the lower third of the illustration of the kit. There in the lower third portion, the second part, the second line, you have color coded parallel pins. Okay, read the text carefully, very tiny text. Parallel pins, these pins are used to assess the parallelism. Okay, we cannot insert the implant anyhow. Okay, it has to be parallel at least, because posteriors usually are parallel. If they are tilted, that's an another case, that's another case scenario, but usually they are or vertical. So you have to assess the parallelism. This parallelism is assessed by these parallel pin. Okay, so after every drill the parallelism has to be assessed. So we started with pilot drills, then we begin with 3 mm. See, first we go horizontally. and finalize the width. Once the width is finalized, then we will proceed lengthwise. Okay, so forget about length now. Our target is to achieve an osteotomy site of 4.3 mm. So we will start with 3 mm. After pilot drill, 3 mm, then 3.5 mm. Okay, the first one is 8 mm. So 3 by 8, 3.5 by 8, 4.3 by 8. Okay, so now our width is final. We proceeded horizontally in sequence. See, the main key factor, key to successful implant placement, is to maintain the order, the sequence of the drills. Okay, don't use it anyhow, it's not going to work. Okay, so 3 by 8, 3.5 by 8, and 4.3 by 8. So 4.3 is our target achieved. Okay, so our width is now final. So now nothing to do with width, so don't proceed in the width section. Horizontal, don't proceed horizontally. Our width is now finalized. Now in that width, if you see, it is color coded. Every width is color coded. So now follow the color coding of 4.3. 8 is done, next is 10. So now use the drill of 4.3 by 10. Okay, and then 4.3 by 11.5. here our osteotomy completes. Okay, now we have achieved the length target also. First we achieve the width target and then follow the color coding lengthwise. Okay, so first use the drills in order horizontally and then in that width section vertically. Okay, this is how we are supposed to use the drills, and in between every drill we have to use those respective parallel pins to assess the parallelism, so that we are not tilting our implants. Our implants are not positioned in a tilted manner, or we are not going out of our way. Okay, the parallelism has to be checked every now and then after every drill. Clear? I hope drills are clear. Okay, so the main thing about drills, order, and then it has to be used with appropriate rotary speed, torque, and irrigation. Irrigation to dissipate or counter act with the heat produced during the bone cutting. Clear? Now once this final osteotomy site is prepared, the next step is not always available with all the implant kit. It varies from implant systems to system. That is the screw tap. Okay, as already discussed in the implant properties, the macro structure, whether they are self tapping or non tapping. See, if they are non tapping, then we have to create the taps with the use of screw tap or thread former. That is, we create the threads of the screw, the threads that are available or visible on the screw. We create those threads in that osteotomy site to which the threads of the implant will match and they will conform with each other. Okay, so to create that negative configuration of the implant threads inside the osteotomy site, we perform one step before implant placement, that is screw tap or thread former. If it is a self cutting one, self tapping one, then no need. This is used only when the implants are non cutting or non tapping. Okay, so this is why we have screw tap. Please refer the kit simultaneously as I am discussing the armamentarium to get a better understanding of the topic. Okay, but if there are any doubts that still exist, feel free to ask me. Okay, I am here to help all of you. Okay, then the next, after threads are created, or even if they are not created, with the implants it will get created. So now the implant insertion. So how that implant is inserted? It's like a screw thing, as you have already seen the pictures. Do you think we will take it with our hand and put it inside the osteotomy site? No, the implant has to be carried. So there are again two manners depending on the implant systems available. In this hands kit, there they mention implant mount. Okay, so the implant mount is inserted in the rotary instrument and then the mount engages the implant. The mount lifts the implant from the wire, the sterile, the clean wire. Okay, and it's absolutely free from contamination. The mount carries the implant from that wire and then with the rotary thing the implant is inserted inside the osteotomy site. Okay, again this implant mount optional, varies from system to system. There are few system in which the implant is directly engaged by the rotary instrument, and there are these systems where they use implant mount to engage the implant, lift the implant and insert it inside the osteotomizide. So now implant is inserted. Okay, now we have the next step, the use of drivers. Okay, even before using the drivers, we have the torque. Okay, to check the primary stability, we have wrenches. It's called wrench, torque wrenches. Okay, ratchet torque wrench. Okay, to give the final torque, controlled torque, not too much. Okay, again, too much tightening will create necrosis. Okay, remember determination of stability. The first step was manual torque. This is that torque, the wrench that they refer to. And the second method was RFA, resonance frequency analysis, by devices such as Austin. Okay, so this torque is used to assess the final stability or provide the final stability by giving controlled torque. Okay, and then we use the drivers. Now don't get confused, the drivers literally means drivers here. Okay, the driver which we have in our daily life, people who hire drivers, how, what they do, they carry you or they take you from one place to another. Same thing these drivers do, they carry or they take the tiny components. Here the tiny component can be either the cover screw or the abutment, either of the one. Okay, so these drivers carry these tiny things and allow us or help us to insert it in the patient's mouth. See, those screws or abutments are tiny things. It's not comfortable or even possible to hold it with our hands or fingers and insert it in the patient's mouth and tighten it. Okay, so we need something bigger to get a better hold of it. Okay, so the handling properties are imparted, better handling properties are imparted by using drivers. These drivers, the shape of the driver is somewhat, see, I am drawing it, this is the handle of the driver, looks like a table lamp. Okay, just see the textbook figure so that you don't get confused with my horrible drawings. So somewhat like this. So this is the handle, we use it in our finger, something like this, and here we have this pointed thing onto which our screw is engaged. This screw is a tiny thing, so onto this our screw is engaged, and then we insert it in the patient's mouth and we can tighten it. So because of this bulky thing, the bulky handle of the driver, the holding is comfortable, is easy, the holding is made easy, and we can actually hold it and insert it in the patient's mouth and we can actually tighten it. Imagine tightening this tiny screw. I really doubt it's possible. The second drawback with not using the drivers and using inserting the screw directly, it's very small. Okay, it's comparatively tiny. So there are chances that we may drop it either outside or inside. See, if it drops outside, contamination, the loss of the material, waste of material, and if it is dropped inside, means chances that patients may swallow it. Okay, so that is why it's safe to use the drivers. The drivers do the actual literal job. They drive the screw or abutment from our surgical table into the patient's mouth. Okay, that's what they do, just like our real life drivers. Okay, so these are the various instruments discussed in the textbook. A quick summary, drills, the most important part. Please, by now I think you must have understood how important these drills are and how important it is to use the drills in the sequence. Then we have screw taps, optional. Implant mount, optional. I mean, not optional, varies from system to system. Okay, certain systems have them, certain systems don't have them. Okay, just check while using or buying one system, just check all of these features. Then we have drivers and we have wrenches. Okay, and the last thing, we have these cover screws. Okay, please refer to the figures, the illustrations simultaneously. Please, I'm repeating again and again, please refer to the figures simultaneously to get a better insight of this topic. Okay, so these are the various instruments. So till now we have discussed connections, internal versus external, platforms, matching versus switching, surgical protocol, one stage, two stage, immediate restoration, immediate implant placement versus placement in the heel site, loading, conventional, immediate, early loading and delayed loading, armamentarium, drills, screw tap, implant mount, drivers and wrenches and cover screws. Okay, so here the armamentarium is complete. Now we are entering the prosthetic part. Till now we were discussing surgical part of the implant treatment. Now we are going to enter the prosthetic part of the implant. Now under prosthetics we have two main terminologies: standardized and customized components. And the second thing, the much more important one, screw retained versus cement retained restorations. Okay, the first part is about the components, second part is about restoration. So under prosthetics we have discussed loading, and now we are discussing the components. These components can be standardized or customized. Here both the things are used even nowadays, okay, but I think the trend is more towards customized. Okay, standardized means the implant manufacturers prepare them in bulk, the stock parts. The components are prepared in bulk based on the general population dimensions requirement. Okay, and customized are more case specific. They are prepared specially for that particular case. It cannot be used in any other case. Okay, that is customized. And the next we have restorations. This is an interesting topic. Restoration can be screw retained or cement retained, or also called as cemented. So cement retained, see the name itself explains, they are very self-explanatory. The retention factor, the retention property of the implant is imparted or obtained from a screw or the cement. Okay, this is more common or easily understood how we perform FPDs. Same way this thing can also be done. If the retention of the final crown is by means of a cement, that is why the term cement retained. Here the important thing to be noted is the abutment used is more often a customized abutment, okay, which is usually prepared by means of calcium. Okay, and here in screw retained, the retention of the crown is by means of a screw. That means the prosthesis is attached to the implant by means of a screw. Okay, and here a standardized abutment works well. Okay, standardized. Now the advantages are, in the screw retained, the retrieval or removal of the crown is easier. We unlock the screw and the crown can be removed in toto. So there is no breakage or damage to the crown if required to retrieve. Whereas in the case of cement retained, for retrieval of the crown we have to cut open it. Okay, we have to make certain cuts in the crown and that's how we break open it. Clear? So that means another crown has to be fabricated after any manipulations or repairs or surgery again done on that site. Okay. So this is the drawback with cement retained, that the crown retrieval is not possible usually. I mean, there are certain cases but not always. Whereas in screw retained, it's very safe. Just unlock that screw and the crown can be removed easily without any more efforts. Okay. So this is the major advantage of screw retained prosthesis. But the drawback, the screw, which is a very tiny part. So the loosening of the screw, the loss of the screw is another big problem associated with screw retained one. Whereas with cement retained, there are no such tiny parts associated. It's just that cement between the crown and the abutment. So no such parts loosening or loss or misplacement, okay, is happening in case of cement retained ones. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of screw retained and cement retained restoration. So this is how we complete this topic, terminologies and armamentarium with associated with dental implants. So in today's video, a quick summary, what all we have discussed: connections, that is external versus internal, platforms, switching versus matching, surgical protocol, one stage, two stage and immediate restoration, immediate implant placement versus placement in heel site, loading, conventional, immediate, early and delayed, armamentarium, drills, screw tap, implant mount, drivers, wrenches and cover screws. Then we have the prosthetics components, standardized and customized, usually the abutments, and the restoration, screw retained and cement retained. So now in the next video we will discuss the other types of implants. There are mainly three types of implant: endosteal or endosseous, then transosteal and apostial. Okay, so in the next video, till now we have discussed endosteal, in the next video we will discuss the apostial, under which we have subperiosteal implants, and then we have transosteal implants and the zygomatic and pterygoid implants. Okay, so the next video is about the other types of implants. Also from this chapter there is one section called peri-implant diseases, which I will be discussing in detail in separate videos. Okay, so with this, the second chapter of the implants textbook Kalmisch is complete, and I hope the entire content is clear to all of you. But if you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comment section below, or you think if I have missed out any other topic which is important to you, then do let me know, bring it to my notice, and I will cover it up in the next video. Okay, thank you for watching and listening to me. I hope the content is helpful to all of you and it is understood well by you, all of you. And do let me know if you have anything else for me to discuss with you all, and I will do the needful. Okay, thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well, have a good day, stay safe.